Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Another tough week for the Flames, and the sell-off before trade deadline has started, with the Flames' first trade being made this morning. And as usual, I'm Dan Stevenson alongside my co-host Matt DeBorg. Matt, how you doing?
Good.
What'd you think of this week for the Flames?
Well, not so good on the ice, but some interesting things happening off the ice and lots of rumors to go through and all that fun stuff. So looking forward to recording the show.
It's our pre-trade deadline episode, so we'll be talking about our picks for trade deadline and what we think we can see with 7 days left until trading is done for the year. And let's jump right into it and look at the past week. This was a big week for the Flames. We had 6 points, 3 games on the board for the week. Flames didn't do so hot, though. Let's break these down one at a time. The first game of the week was the game the Flames played against Minnesota. They dropped 5-3. Matt, your thoughts on this game as a whole?
I thought the Flames probably deserved a better result than they got. A 5-3 loss. I thought Jonas Hiller probably could have had 3 or 4 of the goals that Minnesota scored, and that ended up being the difference.
Yeah, I think that Hiller really cost the Flames this game. Like, you know, sometimes the goalie keeps you in, sometimes he doesn't really keep you in, but I think in this one, he was more of a detriment than anything else.
Yeah, like when Minnesota went up 3-0 and then Calgary scored 2 to bring it within 1, he let in a really soft goal to make it 4-2.
That Pominville goal at the end of the second.
Yeah, and then that was it. And you could tell that, like, okay, yeah, like, this game's over, and because the Flames just don't have that same pushback that they did a year ago. And they did close to within 1, but that just wasn't enough.
Yeah, they moved within 1 when Michael Backlund scored at the about 5 minutes into the first, and then Charlie Coyle ended up getting the empty netter to secure the game. Yeah, I don't know. I was really disappointed in this one by Hiller. I thought that Hiller could have done a lot better. I thought that he really looked like, you know, the Hiller that we saw in his last year and a bit in Anaheim. He just didn't look like he was an NHL goalie. I thought that the Flames looked good in the first period in this one, and as a team, the overall effort was pretty good for the majority of the game. I really liked what we saw from Derek England as well in this game. I thought that Derek England, he's been looking good for the last little bit, and I thought that in this game too especially, he looked quite good.
Yeah, getting off the donut with his first of the season was a good thing.
So, yeah, not a guy that you're expecting to score a lot, and that's his first of the year. And it was assisted by Goudreau and Brody.
Yeah, TJ Brody had a monster week this week.
Yeah, it was a good week for TJ, for sure. And good to see Nicklaudl still playing. He got quite a bit of ice time, 16 minutes of ice time in this game. So it's nice to see that the Flames are really putting some faith behind him. If you remember last year, they called up Wotherspoon and he played not at all after the call-up. And I was kind of worried after Nicklaudl got benched, they wouldn't be playing him much, but he's getting a lot of ice time.
Yeah, and he's actually playing really well in that ice time. I'm not a huge fan of Corsi and all that fun stuff, but in terms of that, like, he's pretty much playing at the similar level as both Giordano and Brody thus far through the 4 games that he's played. And that's a huge step up from any of the bottom 4 defensemen that the Flames have been using, because all of Weidman, Russell, Englund, and Smead have been quite terrible on that metric.
I think, too, if you look at the game that we're seeing Nicklaudl play, you can definitely tell he's a more mature player. He's an older guy. And to me, I think he's definitely earned a contract next year. I mean, he might not be a full-time NHL guy, but I think just based on the limited number of games we've seen him play here, if I were the Flames, I'd try to re-sign him and bring him back next year, because he's going to give some good blue line depth, and I wouldn't be surprised if he made the team.
Oh, no. And especially with his playing responsible defensively and the ability for him to be a bit of a pain to defend on the power play, because he, similar to guys like Brody Hamilton and Giordano, he's able to slide off the point and sneak in for offensive chances. That's could be a very well a good replacement for Russell and potentially Weidman if the Flames decide to move them both.
And speaking of Weidman, it also happened this week that his suspension was upheld by the commissioners, so now they'll be going to arbitration on that one. So as it looks right now, he'll probably be out for the whole 20 games. Even if the arbitration, you know, rules in his favor, it's probably going to be pretty close to 20 games by the time we get a ruling.
Mm-hmm. And at that rate, it would be about the middle of March when he returns, if he's still a Flame, so we'll see.
Yeah, I think he'd be a tough guy to move at the deadline, but we'll talk about that a bit later. So overall, any final thoughts? I thought it was a decent effort, but that Hiller was really the Achilles heel in this one.
Yeah, and that's pretty much been the tale of most of this season. The team puts an okay effort, and the goaltending's kind of let them down.
The next game was quite a good game for the Flames. We were playing against the Vancouver Canucks, our arch rivals. This was a game that the Flames, I thought, really came out playing well right from beginning to end, and they ended up with a 5-2 win over the Canucks. I didn't expect it to be that high when the game started, but we had goals from Colborne, Backlund, Frolik, Giordano, and Juris. And the Juris one was interesting because both Nkladal and Boma got their first assists of the year, which I thought was pretty cool. Overall thoughts on this one, Matt?
I thought that this could have been a game that Hiller could have let this one go, and the two goals that Vancouver scored were kind of on the weaker side, and Calgary did tighten up. Vancouver's not a good team this year at all. It's basically the Sedins and Yannick Hansen, and then nothing else. So if you can shut those three guys down, you're pretty much guaranteed 2 points. And oddly enough, it was the fourth consecutive 5-2 loss for Vancouver, which is the first time that that's happened in NHL history. So, just weird.
Yeah, they're not a great team this year. Again, we saw Sven Berchi looking pretty good. You know, I'm glad that he's got a good home. But yeah, it was a good morale booster for the Flames. I thought that Colborne looked really good in this game. He's a guy that we've sort of seen come up and down this year. Mikael Backlund continued his good play. Really not a lot to say about the Flames besides I thought this was a pretty good effort all the way around. Yes, Vancouver really gave this game to the Flames in a lot of ways, but Hiller pulled up his boots. I wasn't expecting Hiller to get the start here. I honestly thought that after the Minnesota game, they would have started Ordeo. Do you think that if they started Ordeo, we would have seen much of a difference in the score, or do you think it was pretty much just Vancouver falling apart?
I think it was Vancouver falling apart more
too.
Than anything. I think you could have put any of the Flames' organizational goaltenders in, including a guy like Ken Simpson, and the score would have pretty much been the same. They weren't really generating any scoring chances after the first period.
And just as a note, and this will be important later on in the show, but Marcus Granlund was scratched in this game. So, yeah, it was a good game, and it was a fun game to watch as a Flames fan. I like it when we can take it, especially to Vancouver. You know, we had one goal at the end of the first. Vancouver was up 2-1. I thought, crap, the Flames might let this go, knowing them. And then they came back with three strong goals, and after that Giordano goal, I was pretty sure it was going to be our game.
Yeah, even if the Flames finish dead last, as long as we've won the season series against Vancouver, everything's A-okay.
You got to win it against Vancouver, and you got to win it against Edmonton.
Well, that's just assumed.
And then we'll go to the third game of the week, the one that we were worried about. The Flames went back to the Honda Center, the cursed Honda Center, for an earlier game. It was a 5 p.m. Calgary start on Sunday.
22 consecutive losses in the Honda Center.
I looked it up, Matt. The last time we won in the Honda Center, who do you think the Flames goaltender was?
Roman Turek.
Roman Turek.
Yeah, it's been since 2004. I know they mentioned it on the broadcast that Conroy had 4 assists in that game, and Jelena scored.
So we sign both Connie and Jelena to a one-day contract and put them in next time we're there?
Anything that could help.
In this,
I know we're going back there next month, and if the Flames drop that one as well, that will tie the NHL record, which was the Pittsburgh Penguins in the 80s. They lost 23 in a row in Philadelphia.
That's crazy.
The difference being that the Penguins at the time were embarrassingly bad, and to the point where they were going to move if it wasn't for getting Mario Lemieux. So the Flames don't really have any excuse, because we've been a playoff team for most of the seasons. So, yeah, it's just some buildings. Like, even though it's been since 2004, we hadn't won prior to that in, like, 5 years. So it's like, in the last 20 years, the Flames have 1 win in Anaheim. It's just ridiculous.
So if you didn't catch it already, the Flames lost this week. This game, the again this week, and this one was a 5-2 loss for the Flames in the Honda Center. Interesting note in this one, I thought it was interesting the Flames decided to scratch Josh Juris after he got a goal the night before, but I think they wanted to put Bolig in as the big body on the ice.
One of the interesting things with that, and we're going to be discussing this later, Gaudreau's agent is in town, and perhaps with the liberties that some players have been taking on Gaudreau, maybe that was one of the concerns that he brought up, is not having somebody to protect Gaudreau on his line.
Maybe. I mean, that has, you know, the agent can suggest that, but ultimately it's the coach's decision, but maybe. And yeah, that's a good point too, is that not only did Bolig drew in on line 1, which was interesting. Hartley said they wanted to make some changes, but I wouldn't have expected that. I don't think it did him any favors. He still didn't look like he was kind of upping his game to play with those guys, in my opinion. But my take on this game, I thought that Hiller played, for the most part, well against his former team. He could have played better. But, you know, for Hiller, I thought that he played pretty well against his former team. The Ducks, really, I think this one comes down to the Ducks forcing the Flames to make a lot of mistakes. I thought the Flames came out doing a lot of good things in this game. They were playing a solid game, and the Ducks really forced them to make key mistakes at key times, which put them ahead. And then the Flames were the opposite of what they were last year, getting all the puck luck. They had a lot of crossbars and a lot of posts that they hit in this game.
Yeah, well, I think each team had 3 posts in that game. It's just seems that whenever the Flames play in Anaheim, things screw up and conspire to go against the Flames for whatever reason.
See, and I was excited after the second period. We're down 2-1. We had a power play goal. I thought, you know, the Flames scored on the power play for the first time in forever. This is going somewhere.
And then 16 seconds into the third period, bam, 3-1. Okay, game over. Well,
and even at that point, I thought the Flames can still come back, but then they slid so far downhill after that. Like, as we've seen with most Flames games, they got behind and they let it get to their heads.
Mm-hmm. I know, this team is like the exact opposite, where last year they seemed that whenever they'd give up a goal, who cares, we'll come back. And this year it seems anytime they face adversity, they just fall off the face of the earth.
I think it's good to see Anaheim playing well again. I mean, you know, they've got a lot of good players there, but I just wish it wasn't against us. Fairly penalty-filled game, too. Calgary had 12 penalty minutes and Anaheim had 14. But, yeah, I can't really say that there's a Flame that really stood out in this game as a good example for me. What about you, Matt?
I agree.
So Granlund again sat out, and Juris sat out, as we mentioned, and obviously Chris Russell sitting out due to his injury. Nicklaudl drew back in.
Yeah. Nicklaudl played
less in this game, only 10:55.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious with Russell sitting out if it's the same reason that Granlund's been sitting out.
Could be. You think they might be trying to move him?
Oh, I'm assuming that they are, especially with Russell's propensity to block shots. You don't want him to accidentally catch one the wrong way right before you're going to be trading him.
That's true. It could be.
Who knows?
I also thought it was interesting in this game, looking at the time on ice stats, that Giordano had 27 minutes and Brody had 29. Like, you know, Brody played more than a whole period of hockey, and England had 20 minutes. That's a lot of time for Derek England, but he's a big body, so I understand why they want him out there.
Mm-hmm. Well, it doesn't hurt, and especially in a game that's getting away from you, you tend to use your depth players over your better ones anyway. And like up front, a lot of the third and fourth line players played more minutes than they usually do, and I think Gaudreau had fewer than he normally does, so makes sense. Why risk injuries?
So that was the games for the week, but there was a lot happening off the ice that I think is where the majority of our focus will be this week. The rumor was, well, we know for sure that Gaudreau's agent was in town, but the rumor is that he's here to talk contract with the Flames, which would make sense. And I'm hearing rumors that really what the two teams are talking about now is a bridge contract as opposed to, you know, a long-term high-value deal for Gaudreau. I'm not really sure what that bridge deal would look like in terms of money and term, but Matt, I thought I'd throw it around with both of us and see what we think Gaudreau should sign for and if you think a bridge deal or a long-term deal would be right. What are your thoughts?
For me, what I would do is an 8-year, 7.5 per, basically the Vladimir Tarasenko contract, just get it locked down. Yeah, you could, like, if you sign Gaudreau to, a 4-year deal, you could probably get him at, like, 6.5 to 7. But at the end of that contract, if he continues to progress and become one of the star players, then you're going to have to pay him, like, $10 million. And do you want to save a few bucks now to have to spend more later, or do you save more later to spend a little more now? It's one of those, who knows. I would prefer going the longer term route with him.
Yeah, there's two ways to look at that. I mean, if he's gonna be performing at the same level, you definitely, I think, want to get him locked in long term. And I would be okay if this was the biggest deal in Flames history in terms of dollars and money. I think 8 years at 7.5 is more than fair. He's not eligible for a no move, I think, until he's in his 20s when he'd be UFA eligible. But I would imagine there'd be a no trade or no move once that's eligible there.
Mm-hmm.
My only worry on this is what happens if he becomes the next Scott Gomez or Brian Gionta, who signs a huge deal, looks good for maybe 1 or 2 years, and then we're stuck with big money for the long term.
Well, there's a risk of that with literally every player in the NHL. So the fact that he's been basically the best, most awesome player at every level since he was a kid, I don't see that magically vanishing and not returning. There's always a risk that, you know, like, he could get hit the wrong way and suffer injury troubles for the remainder of his career. But that's the risk that, you know, the same thing could happen to Monahan or Bennett or Giordano or Brody. So I think signing him longer term would at least give you some cost certainty. And that way you could be more easily able to structure the team. Like, if you sign him to a 3 or a 4 year contract, then you've got Brody coming off at the same time, and you might end up getting into a bit of a cap crunch, especially if Gaudreau does remain, like, one of the top scorers in the league, and will need, like, a $10.5 to $11 million after that.
No, I agree with you. I think I personally would go long-term on him for sure. I think he's worth it. One of my worries, and I was thinking about this today, is we saw when, if you remember, when they're trying to get Gaudreau originally signed when he was in college, there was a lot of talk at the time of, will he sign or will he take his fourth year and, you know, then become a UFA? I'm wondering if he wants to be here in Calgary long term, or maybe he only wants the bridge deal and to go to UFA after that. He wasn't a Canadian boy growing up. He wasn't a Calgary fan. We know he's from the New Jersey area. I wonder if maybe he's got some desire to not lock in long term here and not give up UFA years.
Well, that too is a concern of pretty much every player anywhere that's North American. So, like, say, like Taylor Hall, he grew up a huge Flames fan, you know.
But I guess, like, Hall signed right away, though, and we saw that uncertainty with Goodrow trying to get that deal done, which I think might show some hesitancy there.
Well, it's one of those things that we'll have to wait and see, and I think concerns about that are completely overblown, in my opinion. I think it's just a matter of figuring out what works for both sides and then putting pen to paper. I don't see, like, especially with how Gaudreau's been treated by Flames fans and idolized by Flames fans, I don't see the desire to basically become public enemy number one. Because that's pretty much what would happen if he were to abandon ship. So, I don't know. I just think that it's just a matter of time for a contract to be signed and then see what the deal is and then react then.
What would be the maximum that you'd want to pay Johnny Hockey per year?
On this contract, no more than 8 per, if it's for a long, like 8-8 type deal. And if it's a shorter deal, like say 3 years, then no more than 6.5.
Yeah, I think if we can lock him up 8 years, it's 7.5 to 8, somewhere in there. I think that's going to be a good deal overall. You know, and if he continues to play the way he is, that'll be a good deal. And it'll let the Flames, like you said, have some cost certainty with, you know, the Canadian dollar uncertain and the cap uncertain. It'll let us build that team for long term. And I think also help attract players here, knowing that we have a long term piece locked in.
Yeah, it's the same thing back when Aginla was here, that you had him as being the drawing card. Like, oh, come sign, we'll put you with Aginla. Well, it's the same thing with Gaudreau, and especially with there being plenty of right-wingers on the market on UFA day, if the Flames are targeting one of them, you can say, you know, like, say, like a Kyle Okposo, you can say, hey, we're going to put you with Johnny Gaudreau. You guys can have fun together. And that would be more exciting than, say, going to Vancouver or something where it's just not the same. So we'll see.
Ginla made $7 million a year when he was here for most of his prime in Calgary, arguably maybe past his prime. So if Goodrow got anything more than that, I believe he'd be the highest paid Flame.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
To throw on the jersey, because we have nobody really close to that this year. We've got some. The closest we've got is Giordano making 6.75, but that doesn't happen until 2019-2020. Oh, no, that's happened starting next year. That'll be Goodrow will be close, or Giordano will be close, and I think Goodrow will be above that.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'm hoping it gets done, and with the agent here in town, I'm hoping it gets done fairly quickly. I'd like to kind of see that lock in, and I think that's going to help other guys make their decision going forward about if they want to be in Calgary or move somewhere else. And, you know, I agree with you. You know, it's been said about the uncertainty with him signing and all that, but Goodrow's given us no reason to think that he wouldn't sign here. You know, we've been nothing but good to him. We've been nothing but good to his family. I see no reason why he wouldn't sign here. I think people that think maybe there's some uncertainty there, it's really unfounded.
Yeah, it's a lot, very much overblown. Just like, oh, he wouldn't sign here after college. Like, if he didn't want to be a Flame, he could have just held out for another year and then just sign with whomever. So,
and I mean, if he was really upset after they benched him for a game, he could have sat out. He could have refused to play or demanded a trade. I think that, you know, he wants to be here as much as anybody else. There's no evidence that he doesn't. The other big piece of news this week, if we move on, was the Flames have jumped in 7 days before the trade deadline and made their first trade, and one of the few first trades that's happened this week, but their first trade of the year. going back to a somewhat familiar trading partner from last year, the Flames made a one-for-one deal, trading Marcus Granlund to the Vancouver Canucks in exchange for Hunter Shinkaruk. And just as kind of a tale of the tape for those who don't know these guys, let's start with the incoming Flame, Hunter Shinkaruk. Shinkaruk was born October 13th, 1994, which makes him 21 years old. He's played for the Utica Comets for most of the year, wearing number 9. So obviously if he comes up to Calgary, that's going to have to change. He has a $925,000 contract. He was drafted first overall, or first round, I believe.
Two picks after Poirier.
Right, two picks. I think that was, 23rd overall?
24th.
24th. Okay, so at the time, there's a lot of people who were sad that we took Shinkaruk over Poirier, and now we don't need to worry about that anymore because we've got them both. So, you know, no matter which way you look at it, you've got both guys. And Hunter Shinkaruk is a left winger. He's 5'11" and 180, so not a huge guy. And he's had a really good year so far in Utica. If we take a look at his stats, he played 45 games, 21 goals and 18 assists for 39 total points. Only played one game with the Canucks this year. On his way out is Marcus Granlund, 22-year-old from Finland, same height. $792,000 contract, and he's a centerman in the organization. So Matt and I were joking before the show. We wonder if Benning got confused and traded for the wrong Granlund. He didn't know there were two of them. He thought he was getting Mikael instead of Marcus.
Well, I actually was thinking that Granlund might have been on his way out. We were going to be doing our draft predictions and or trade deadline predictions, and I was going to suggest that he was going to get dealt for a goaltender. So him getting traded for a similar player that's a left winger, I can't really complain too much about that.
I've liked Marcus Granlund since we drafted him. I thought he was a good pick. You know, I've been a fan of his as he's moved through the AHL, but I think that Granlund is never going to really get a shot to be what he could be here. He's a centerman, and I think he'll always be a 3-4 center because you got Bennett and you got Monahan as your 1-2 guys.
Yeah, and then if you sign Jankowski, he's likely going to take one of those other two spots. And then you've got Bill Arnold and Drew Shore in the minors. There's just no room.
We just have so much center depth that I think that Granlund would get the raw end of the stick either way.
Yeah, and the Flames did try Granlund on the wing in Stockton, and he just did not look good at all there and was not comfortable with it. So between having no good scoring left winger depth in the minors, getting one for him, you're trading from an area of strength for an area of weakness, and it's good for Vancouver because they can slot Granlund in the lineup right away, and it's good for us because we don't have to lose Granlund on waivers next year. We get 2 extra years of waiver eligibility there, so we can be more patient with Shinkaruk.
I think
instead
that with
of rushing them.
Vancouver looking like they're going to go through a rebuild fairly soon, I think that we might see Granlund as one of the key pieces of that. I can also see him and Berchi playing together.
So can I. And realistically, that would be a good fit for Vancouver because of the fact that when Granlund and Berchi played together briefly in Calgary, they did look like they had some chemistry with each other. Vancouver's trying to kind of rebuild on the fly without actually rebuilding, which, you know, that's not a good way to do it, personally, but I think that's just going to prolong the mediocrity of the team, but that's neither here nor there. That's their team. I don't like them, so good, fine by me, but...
So Hunter Shinkaruk got assigned immediately to Stockton, and it's been announced he'll be wearing number 16 in Stockton. He can't wear number 9. It's taken by Garnet Hathaway. But if we look at the left wingers that the Flames have in Stockton, they have Mason Raymond, Kenny Agostino, Hunter Shinkaruk, Morgan Klimchuk, and Bryce Van Bibrandt. And I think if I look at that list, I've really only got Shinkaruk and Klimchuk, who I think might have the potential to be top 6 wingers. So, you know, I think this really brings another top-level prospect, another elite prospect into the Flames. And you can never go wrong bringing a prospect like that in. Even if he doesn't make it here the way that we'd expect him to, you can always move that prospect down the road. But I'm excited. I think that we will see Shinkaruk probably get a call up this year, and if not, I think he'll probably make the team next year out of camp.
It's possible, and I think what you alluded to, I think what you'll see down the road is Shinkaruk being the second line left winger, potentially with Klimchuk being the third line winger. Whether that's how it pans out or not is still to be determined, but I could see that being an eventual setup for the team.
Yeah, I don't think we'll see that necessarily next year or, you know, anything like that. I think that Shinkaruk, I mean, he's only 21. He's got development time, and there's no need to rush him. You know, he is a great prospect, I think. He's got a lot of potential. But to me, I wouldn't rush him. But, yeah, I think he's definitely got that top six potential if he reaches his potential. And if not, I think he's probably going to have an NHL job for most of his career, even as a, you know, third line guy. So you're going to be watching Stockton Heat as you are all season. Are you looking forward to seeing where Shinkaruk fits into their lineup, Matt?
Yeah, I'll be curious to see because I haven't really paid too much attention to him since when he was in his draft year. So I'm curious to see how far he's actually progressed since then. And also to note, Shinkaruk is 19th in the entire AHL in points and only 4 points out of being in the top seven. So
I mean, with him and unfortunately Grant is hurt now, but if those two were together, that would be a heck of a pairing.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, some people said it's too bad that he's so small, but really we trade a small guy for a small guy. So to me, it's net neutral there. It's not like we trade a 6'4" guy for a 5'10" guy.
Yeah, and he also is physically strong for his size, where Granlund's more of a passive player. So stylistically, Shinkaruk's more like a Bennett type of player than Granlund, who's more of a backline type.
Yeah, I think Shinkaruk has a better offensive upside than Granlund ever would.
So do I.
Are you surprised that this deal went down 1-for-1?
Yes and no. I can see the reason why each team would do it. Like, Granlund has produced pretty much at the same rate offensively. So, and he is ready now, where Shinkaruk's probably a year or two away. So with Vancouver trying to rebuild on the fly, that kind of makes sense. But I think the Flames, to make it even, they probably would have had to include a fifth or so round pick. But they didn't, so...
Well, that was the thing I thought when I saw this come through the wire today. I'm thinking, okay, I'm seeing Shinkaruk for Backlund. Shinkaruk for Granlund. And I thought the Flames must have given something up. I got to go check. And I went to TSN and it said it was 1-for-1. I'm like, huh, maybe all the pieces haven't been reported yet. So I went to a couple other outlets and I was really surprised that the Flames were able to do this 1-for-1. I know that since this deal happened today, there's been a lot of mixed reactions online. I think this is nothing but positive for the Flames. I mean, I like Granlund. I'm sad to see him go, but we got a much-needed winger. We got a younger player and a guy who gives us more waiver flexibility. And anytime I think you can bring in a first-round pick, you're doing well without giving up, you know, the future. So if you look at it, I think we gave up a guy who's destined to be a third-line center for a potential second-line winger.
Yeah, and I think the mid... main reason why the Flames made this trade was Granlund having to be exposed to waivers next year. And I think it's the same situation as a year ago with Berchi being in that situation this season. And that lack of flexibility and the fact that the Flames do have an insane amount of center depth, he would get lost in the shuffle, and he hasn't really stood out thus far this season in Calgary to say, oh, he's deserving of a spot. And he should be playing every night. And that's why he's been being benched somewhat regularly off and on ever since he got recalled.
Yeah, he was in a weird spot because he was too good for the AHL, but he hasn't really been able to create a name for himself as an NHLer.
And you get to the point where you have to either put up or move on. And I think he hasn't put up enough to say, oh, he should be a full-time guy for the long term. So they moved on. They got a similar guy in Shinkaruk in terms of overall potential, but they have a little bit more flexibility. And especially with the last two drafts, them not having enough picks and most of the guys already graduating into professional hockey, getting somebody that could be a player 2 years from now, that will help offset some of the immediate problem of not enough players coming beyond the immediate group.
Well, I also think that it gives the Flames a lot more options. Like, you might have seen a guy like Klimchuk perhaps rush to the major roster, or a guy like Agostino maybe getting more chances than he should have. And I think that this really cements us with, you know, a good option there that we don't have to use right away. He's only 21, but a good option when we're ready to bring up. So I'm happy with this deal. I'm a little bit shocked. This is the first deal the Flames did this year in what's expected to be their year of selling. But
well, the second deal, because we did acquire Kevin Poulin for cash, so, or whatever it was. So, yes.
That's, well, we, yeah, future considerations. We don't know what exactly they gave. It could have been a foot rub. You never know. So, yeah, no, I think it's interesting that this is the deal that the Flames started with, but I'm really happy with the deal. I think that Shinkaruk will grow on fans here, and I think a lot of people have some hate on for him because he was a Canuck, and I think sometimes he's got some undue hate that I've seen online from Flames fans just because he was drafted by the Canucks, but I remember the...
Oh, yeah, well, rivalries are always rivalries. We're going to be naturally predisposed to hate anything Vancouver.
Well, that's it, and with the amount of, you know, comment there was when the Flames drafted Poirier, you could tell that people really wanted him at the time, so... You know, he's a Flame now, so appreciate him for what he can bring. Try to watch him in Stockton if you can, and remember that now he's on our side.
Yep, and hopefully he does reach his potential and becomes a dangerous scoring threat for the Flames for a long time.
And he's a Calgary boy, so there's actually a bit of a, well, not quite yet, but when he gets called up, this will be a bit of a homecoming for him.
Yeah.
And it has been announced as well that Granlund will report to the NHL Vancouver Canucks, so he's not going to be sent to the AHL, and it sounds like they're looking at putting him right into their lineup. So good for him for staying at the NHL level and really for finding a team who, just like Berchi, who really wants him, you know, and I think both guys were kind of on the outs with the Flames. So if you can find a buyer, good for you.
And thank you to John Weisbrod for being the assistant general manager in Vancouver. So the players that the Flames drafted in 2011, we have a place that we can send them.
Well, that's it. This was one of the guys that was drafted when Feaster Weisbrod were here, and it's almost like Weisbrod wants all his guys back.
You're not getting Gaudreau, Vancouver. He's ours.
They'll probably offer us both Sedins for him.
Yeah. He's ours. Back away.
Interesting, too, that we've had 2 years we've made, I think, significant trades, not, you know, blockbusters, but significant for both teams with one of our rivals. There's been a long-standing tradition that the Flames and the Oilers didn't trade, and that's been broken a few times. But it seems like, you know, us and Vancouver are becoming regular trading partners. And if you look over the past couple of years, this year and last year, really what you get is Calgary shipping out Granlund and Berchi, and getting back Shinkaruk and the pick that gave us Rasmus Anderson. So if you look at that over 2 years, I think we've got the better Vancouver.
Yeah, but we'll see. It largely depends on what both Shinkaruk and Anderson develop into. Both Berchi and Granlund are at least NHL players, where the other two, they have higher potential, but not every player actually reaches their potential. So Vancouver does have the opportunity to actually win each of these trades. So anytime that each side has something that they can say, hey, we did something that improved our team. That's a good thing. Whether it works out for the Flames long term is still to be determined. Same thing for Vancouver. It's one of those situations that we'll have to look back in 5 years to see who won.
Yeah, I think we'll end up finding that even if Shinkaruk doesn't have a great career as a Flame, I think at least right now there's still a lot of potential there, and we might end up seeing him moved on to somewhere else for something else down the road. Anything else you want to talk about this trade, Matt?
Not really. I'm just looking forward to seeing what Shinkaruk brings. And
who do you think they'll put him with in Stockton?
Honestly, I have no idea. I don't. I would rather just wait and see who they put him with, because to speculate, the lineup is kind of in flux with all the injuries and that, so it's not been consistent the last couple of games, so I can't even really tell you who would go where.
I also wonder if this is a bit of a nail in the coffin for Mason Raymond, who I kind of thought would be the first call up on left wing, and if this is kind of now setting Raymond down to sort of that veteran AHL / number two call up position.
We will see.
Because I don't think Shinkaruk's quite ready yet, but I think he's ready to take on a couple games.
Well, I think what you'd more likely see is Kenny Agostino getting recalled first, just to see.
I think if it's long term, they'd probably recall Agostino. Yeah.
Well, it depends on, like, after the deadline, if they want to start testing out a bunch of guys just to give them a game or two, then, you know, then Shinkaruk makes sense. But I don't see him being the first or second recall. I think both Agostino and Raymond would be the more likely choices.
Okay. We'll see. I'm not sure what the GM would do, but I'm glad to see that they're starting the trading early. And speaking of trading, that brings us to our weekly discussion about the trade deadline. We're now 7 days out from the deadline, and this is really when we start to see things heating up. We've already seen the Flames make one deal, and we're starting to see some other teams making some deals. We saw Polak shipped out today. We saw Matthias shipped out. Matt, do you want to talk about those deals specifically and how you think those are going to set prices going forward?
Yeah, Sean Matthias was sent to Colorado for Colin Smith and a fourth round pick. So a fourth line caliber prospect and a pick. And Roman Polak and Nick Spaulding were traded from Toronto to San Jose for a pair of second round picks in 2017 and 2018. Now
And Rafi Torres.
Oh, yeah, well, he's staying in San Jose's farm team, even though he's now a property of player with the Leafs, so I don't see Torres getting recalled anytime soon.
Is he on his last year of his deal, do you know?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, that makes sense then.
Yeah, and the reason why those are important is Sean Matthias, his return is about what you would expect for a decent third, fourth line guy. And Polak's return, there's not too many quality defensemen from the selling teams, because usually, at least this year, most of the teams that are in seller mode, the reason why they're so bad is their defense is terrible. So there's only like five or six defensemen that are worth trading for. So him getting 2 second-round picks... Spaulding, he's worth about a third himself, so if you want to equate it, it's like getting a second and a third for Polak. Overall, I think that helps to set the market for what the pieces that the Flames have to sell, because the Flames do have about 8 or 9 players that they could potentially trade, and seeing what Matthias got, what Polak got, helps to indicate what players like Bolig, Jones, Chris Russell, potentially Derek England, those types of guys, what those guys would get in return.
Why don't we dive in? We teased this last week that we're going to talk about the trade deadline and our predictions for the NHL, and not the NHL in a whole, but I guess the Calgary Flames as we get close to the NHL trade deadline. And Matt, I think we can both agree at this point the Flames will be sellers.
Oh, for sure. When you're 10 points out with 25 games to go, yeah, you're not making the playoffs. So sell what's not strapped down and move on.
And I'm thinking, I don't know what you think, but overall, I think that this is going to be a big sales year for the Flames. I think they have a lot of saleable pieces, and I think we're going to see more than just UFAs moving out of here.
Yeah, and realistically, one of the benefits of having so much depth in Stockton is that you can move out more than what you would normally and have quality replacements, because the Flames have about 7 or 8 forwards that could play from Stockton in the NHL, at least on a temporary 20-game basis. And the Flames also have a handful of defensemen still in Stockton that could play. So between the two, there are options.
I think in the past, this team has been criticized for moving guys too late, moving them past their prime value years. I mean, you know, we heard that with Jerome McGinley. People had said that about Kiprusoff. We saw Camilleri not get a return. So I really think that there's going to be a little bit of pressure on this regime to make sure that we're moving guys when the value's highest for them, if we possibly can.
And you also have to look at the fact that each of the last 2 years, the Flames have had fewer draft picks than what they were allocated. I think they only selected 11 times in the last two seasons. And with the amount of draft picks that the Flames had from, say, 2010 to 2013, that helped push the rebuild forward. But now, in the last 2 years, we haven't had enough picks, so we're kind of set back a bit in terms of replacement players beyond that. So once guys like Poirier, Klimchuk, now Shinkaruk start to graduate, there's not really anything to replace them. So getting additional draft picks is a priority, and having the amount of players that you can sell, that's a good thing, because now we can get a whole whack of picks from the first round through the seventh and have enough of a base where the Flames could potentially restock the farm for like two seasons from now when all the other players have graduated or moved on.
So why don't we jump into this? Let's start with the UFAs, but before we do, some numbers everybody needs to know. The Flames are projected to have $9 million and change available under the cap on deadline day, and we currently have 47 of our 50 possible contracts. So those are the numbers the Flames will be playing with. Matt, why don't we start by talking about what we both think for Jari Hudler, one of the UFAs at the end of the year. Do you think there's any question that the Flames will be moving Hudler?
Not at all. I think I like Hudler, both on the ice and off the ice. And if on July 1st the Flames offer him a contract and he comes back, fine, awesome. But he is small. He's a little slower than what the Flames would like. And the Flames really have an onus to try and get bigger physically so that when we play Anaheim and LA and San Jose, Winnipeg, that we're not going to be getting pushed around by those teams. So, unfortunately, the casualty of that is a player like Hudler who's decent but is undersized, and when you have a guy like Gaudreau who's already small, you can't really have too many players like that.
And to me, it's not just his size, it's also his contract. He's making $4 million this year. We're going to want to cut some of that so that we can move that money on to Gaudreau and Monahan. I think just looking at that contract, you got to let him go.
Well, he's more than provided value for what he's getting paid. It's what he's going to want. And
I mean, he's 32. He's tied for the oldest forward with Stajan. I wouldn't want to sign this guy long-term, even if we brought him back 1-2 years.
Yeah, and realistically, he's going to look at what Camilleri got and say, well, I'm producing at the same or better clip than he was, So I'm going to want a 5-year, $5.5 to $6 million contract, and that just doesn't make sense for the Flames at this point. But
I
other teams, other teams will look at him and say, hey, he scored 76 points a year ago. And he's got 33 already this year, so that's fine. So it doesn't make sense for us, unfortunately.
And I think we're selling him at the right time, because for a lot of this year, Jiří Hudler didn't look anything like the way we saw him last year. Now we're starting to see him coming around again. What do you think the Flames get for Hudler?
I think a minimum of a first-round pick, and I wouldn't be surprised if the Flames got a first plus a good prospect.
Yeah, I had the same on my list here. I said that I think the Flames are going to get a pick and a prospect. I don't know if it'll be a good prospect, but I think the Flames are going to be looking for a first plus to come back.
Yes, yeah. The prospect would likely be in the same range as a guy like Granlund in terms of value. Whether it's a immediate prospect or someone who's a little raw, or who knows, but we don't even know what position the guy would be. So
my guess is the Flames would probably be looking for a winger prospect. Just looking down our depth chart.
A right winger would make the most sense.
Right winger, yeah. I mean, even a left wing, but I think that they'd probably be getting a right winger here. I don't think that you're going to get a first plus an NHL roster player. I think that's too rich for where the market's going to be this year. I think you could get an NHL roster player right winger, but I think right now the Flames need that first round pick.
Yes.
And they need it this year. The next guy on our list is a UFA on the forwards, is a year younger than Hudler, but making the same. It's David Jones at $4 million. What would you do if you were the GM looking at Jones?
Move him to whichever team wants a good third line right winger. He has plenty of playoff experience, has 15 points playing primarily on the Flames' fourth line, 9 goals, which that kind of production from the fourth line is atypical. And I think that the Flames could get a third-round pick, maybe a third plus a later-round pick.
Interesting. See, I've flip-flopped on Jones over last week. I think we'll see the Flames offer Jones a contract come July 1st, because he's one of the few veteran right-wingers out there, but I don't think it'll be anywhere near $4 million.
No.
But I can see them throwing a deal at this guy just because, you know, he's the devil you know, and why not bring him back at an affordable rate? But a week ago when you and I talked, I thought that they wouldn't send Jones away. I thought that, you know, they would keep him here. But with the season not being salvageable at this point, there's no reason not to get rid of one of your two right wingers. Try somebody else at a right wing position. I think they'll trade Jones. I think a third round's probably about what they look for, but I would not be surprised. I don't think that we're going to trade Jones on his own. I don't know that the market's there. I think you'll see Jones packaged with something else.
And I could see a team like, say, Dallas, who needs a solid right winger, a trade where you would send like Jones plus a Rutzel for something slightly more.
Yeah, see, I was looking at something like Jones and Juris, or Jones and Granlund, where Jones is kind of the key piece, but you're getting that young player in as well.
Yeah, I can see that too.
And I don't think the Flames are going to get a third. I think this one is going to sort of be the reverse of Hudler. I think you're going to get a good prospect and a marginal pick. With Hudler, I think you're going to get a good pick and sort of a marginal prospect. I think this one's going to flip. I think the Flames might be looking for, this might be the package that brings them back another young goaltender or a goaltending prospect, but I think you might see a fifth round pick here if you're lucky. So, because I mean, you know, there's only so many guys available late in the draft, and I think if you're taking a late round pick on this one, you want to get a commodity, you know.
Yeah, I can't argue with that.
Those are the only two UFAs we have this year. Let's talk about, or on the forward side, let's move down to the defense, and then we'll talk about some of the other guys. Chris Russell, again, any question that this guy doesn't move out of here on the 29th?
I think that's the reason why the Flames have held him out for the last four games, not wanting him to get hurt. So in my mind, I have no question that he's going to be on his way out. And with the defense market being what it is, and the fact that there's nobody, and that teams are needing defense, I could honestly see him getting a first round pick from a good team.
And I think now's the time to sell him. I don't think he'll ever be worth in his career more than he is right now.
No. And teams look at, like, in terms of the playoffs, he is more than willing to block shots. He can pass the puck from behind his net to the opposition's blue line and tape to tape. He's fairly good offensively, reasonably okay defensively. That's the type of players that playoff teams want. And whether he gets a first-round pick or a similar caliber prospect, I could see either way. It depends on which team. I could even see him going for a good defense or goaltender prospect as well. Because, like, the Flames have been tied with Matt Murray from Pittsburgh.
Apparently Pittsburgh said today that Murray's not for sale.
Well, that could also be posturing to try and get something back more. Who knows? But it all depends. But I think that you're going to get a first or a similar caliber player for Russell.
I identified three teams in my notes here where I think we might see Russell go. The Penguins are lacking some defensive depth. I could see them bringing him in, and like you said, maybe Murray comes back there. With the Blues having Pietrangelo out, I can see them potentially knocking on the door for Russell. And I can also see the Avalanche, if they're trying to make a real run for the playoffs this year, looking to bring him in.
Yeah, I could see that in each case.
So I wouldn't be surprised. I honestly think the best fit for him would probably be the Penguins. They've had sort of a weird year, and I think they could use some depth there. But
yeah, I can agree.
I think the biggest deal that gets done on the 29th or leading up to is going to be Russell. I think you're going to get a better return for him than you are for Hudler. What do you think?
I actually agree. With the lack of defenders on the trade market, realistically, the only two guys that are remotely good are Dan Hamhuis from Vancouver and Chris Russell. Everybody else, it's more depth guys like Pulak, who got dealt today, that if you're just looking for a physical 6 guy, well, if a physical 5-6 guy got 2 second round picks, you know, the market is really nuts at the moment. So
I think for Russell, I put down here that we'll get a first and a top prospect. And I think that prospect in this one especially, I think the Jones deal might give you sort of a prospect that's not pro. I think this could get you a first and a pro goaltender. An AHL goalie, but a pro goalie.
I could see that.
I also, when we were talking about Hudler, I found three teams that I thought he might work well on, and I want to pose some to you in just a minute here, but I thought Hudler could go to the Penguins as well. They really need a forward to complement Crosby and Malkin. The Wild are looking terrible because of a lack of offense recently, and the Islanders need some depth scoring.
Yeah, I would add one more to that, and that's the Dallas Stars. They have no right wingers. It's weird that they're as good as they are, and it's all because they're left wingers and their centers. Like, they have Cody Eakin as one of their top 6 right wingers. Like, anytime that you're forcing a third line guy at best into your top 6, you've got problems.
What do you think the likelihood would be that Hudler and Russell both get moved at the same time to the Pens?
I could see that, but with Dallas, actually, more so.
You think
so? Because Dallas has also been saying that they want a defenseman as well. So if the Flames could pry a guy like Valerie Nikushkin or, you know, and picks or prospects, that could work. Pittsburgh would be the other alternate, and that would be a situation where I could see them letting Murray go plus prospects and picks. So
yeah, see, that's where I think it gets interesting. If you move them individually, I think the big return on both is going to be a first-round pick. If you move them together, I think that's where you start talking about a young roster player coming back.
Yeah, and picks.
Yeah, so for sure. But I think that key piece becomes a guy like Nikushkin or some young roster player, young goalie, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
A couple other UFAs, Jakub Nekladl, you think he goes anywhere?
I think he's a longer-term piece with the Flames.
And do you think we'll find a buyer for either of our goaltenders?
I could see somebody wanting, like, if they have absolutely no faith in their backup, I could see somebody wanting Hiller in exchange for the backup. With how poorly Hiller's played, though, I don't see us getting anything beyond whomever their backup is. So, like, San Jose with Stalock, it would be a one-for-one Hiller for Stalock.
I think that Hiller had more value in January when he was actually playing a couple and looking good, and right now I think he's played himself out of a trade.
And that could very well be.
You know, I think even with a guy like Stalock, if you want to make a trade for a goalie and you're a playoff team, I think you're almost better to stay with the devil you know than the devil you don't, and, you know, bring in a guy like Hiller, especially at a $4.5 million. I know it's only till the end of the year, but
still,
I don't know.
Yeah.
I probably wouldn't absorb that. I'd just stay with the guy that I know or try to, you know, wrestle out somebody's AHL goalie.
Can't argue with you.
So
that's the only situation I could see it as, if they have absolutely zero faith in their goaltender, their backup, and are thinking of Hiller being the Hiller of old instead of what is now.
Looking at some of the RFAs, do you think there's any chance that we would have a buyer for Yoni Ordeo?
Probably not. If somebody did offer something, like above, like a fifth round pick, sure.
I could see Ordeo traded as a throw in to replace somebody else's goaltender. So let's say that we were to trade Russell for Murray. I can see us, you know, sending Ordeo back simply as a piece to replace the goaltender.
Yeah, then I agree with you there.
But I don't think that he's worth a lot by himself.
No.
Tyler Wotherspoon, we saw him come up this week. He got reassigned before the Ducks game. I really think this is the Flame scene. If there's anything left in Wotherspoon, I don't think there's any trade value for him.
No. He might be a toss-in, but that's about it. And I don't see that even. So I think the Flames are going to just run with him for the remainder of the season and see if he can work out his game. And he has played well in the two games. So if he can figure it out and contribute, then that's awesome. That'll build some value. If not, then he's the type that gets claimed off waivers, if that even. So I wouldn't see there being any return for him.
And I think with the Flames depth chart, especially on the blue line now being a lot more deep, I think that he really has to really show management this year that he's worth something, or they're just going to let him go.
Can't argue with that.
So, Matt, we've pretty much agreed that we think that we're going to lose Jari Hudler. We think we're going to lose David Jones, and we think that we're going to end up losing Chris Russell, the three big UFAs. Is there anyone who's not on an expiring contract that you don't think will be wearing a flaming C come March 1st?
I think Michael Backlund, Joe Colborne, and potentially Derek Englund will also join those other guys on their way out.
Interesting. So Colborne's an RFA. He's making 1.27. What kind of return would you expect for Colborne?
Probably a decent either pick or prospect or potentially a similar-ish type guy. So, like, if the Flames say, like, they're looking at Montreal, potentially a guy like Lars Eller might make sense. He does have 22 points in 49 games, which a lot of teams would look at that production for a third-line player and say, hey, that's acceptable. I think that Colborne's just a little too soft for what the Flames are looking for. And I could see a lot of teams being interested in adding that, because anytime you have somebody that's that tall, that's always a good add. So I think that a lot of teams would be interested, and I think the Flames might be interested in moving away from him as well.
Interesting. It's come out that, I mean, he was added to the Flames roster because Burke was doing a favor for his dad. So I'm not sure what, you know, sort of loyalty there is there, and if they would move him or not. But, you know, I could see him moving. I didn't have him on my list here, but I wouldn't be surprised if Colborne's not a Flame, but I also could see them sticking around, keeping him around just because of his size.
And that's... He's basically replacing Granlund as my dark horse to get moved.
Okay.
So...
You also mentioned that you think that Michael Backlund might get moved. Yeah. Coming into this year, I think that Backlund was a pretty good chance to get moved. They've talked about moving him for years, and I think he had a lot of value there when he, you know, when he was a younger player. Even coming into this year, I'm not sure I'd move Michael Backlund as much anymore. I took him off my list a couple weeks ago because I think that he's having a good year. And I think the chemistry he's having with Bennett, I almost want to let them play together for another year and see how that works.
Yeah. I think that my thought on Backlund is a trade with Tampa Bay, actually. And I think that if...
Don't tell me Drouin's coming back.
That's exactly who I'm thinking. And I think that Backlund plus something decent... Perhaps one of the picks that you get back from Hudler or Russell, depending on what it is, or say a Flames second round pick, I think that might be enough to convince Tampa to move away from Drouin. Especially the longer that situation goes on, the more his value drops. So... You know, Backlund is a quality second, third line center. He has 30 points in 58 games. That's fairly good production. And the Lightning are looking like they're going to be losing Stamkos, so they will need a quality second, third line center. So it could be a fit.
If the Flames move Backlund, which I don't, I hope they don't. I could see them doing it, but I hope they don't. I want to tease that chemistry out a bit more, but I think this is a guy who doesn't go for picks. I think if Backlund
moves, for a top prospect.
Maybe a prospect. I would only, if it was me, I'd only move him for a roster player, and I think this is where you might get one of your right wingers back.
Yeah, I could see that. The reason why I'm thinking like a top prospect is somebody that you could just stick in your lineup pretty much right now. Like,
yeah, well, I guess it depends on prospect. I think this would not be a guy that I would trade for, like, a, you know, an OHL prospect or an unsigned prospect.
Not at
this
all.
This has got to be an AHL level.
Yeah, on the cusp to make the NHL. Somebody that's more ready than Shinkaruk.
Exactly.
And a higher level of talent than Shinkaruk.
Higher level of talent, I think somebody who's ready almost the... I know it's a bad analogy because we just moved him, but the Marcus Granlund or the Derek Grant of whoever we move him to, that guy who's too good for the A, but they don't have roster room for him. I think that's who you got to bring back for Backlund, and I would expect that player to be immediately put into the Calgary roster. I think this is where you're going to get not a 20-year-old hotshot, but a 22, 23, 24-year-old.
Yeah, and that's why
I want to give a spot.
Yeah, and that's why I'm thinking Tampa for Drouin, only because Tampa's in the playoff race. They were just in the Stanley Cup Finals. They could easily get there again. So, depending on how the playoffs shake out. So, having a guy that is a very good quality second, third line center that just does nothing but provide depth in the playoffs. And he did score that overtime game winner against Anaheim last year. The Flames only win in that series. So he does have that track record of producing in the postseason. I think it would be a good fit, whether that shakes out or not. The reason why also I think Backlund will be moved is the moving of Bennett from wing to center the last couple of games. And if you have Monahan and Bennett... as your 1-2 centers, and you have guys that are coming up like Jankowski, like Arnold, and that they're going to need playing time. You also have guys like Juris and Colborne who are also centers potentially.
That's a good point. I mean, we just moved Granlund because we had too much center depth, so you're not going to drop a guy like...
Yeah, and you have Boma who can play center.
Yeah, you're not going to drop a guy like Backlund down to third line center at 3.5 a year.
No, because then you're just kneecapping his value if you're relegating him to the third line, because he's not going to get the offensive point totals. So his value is pretty much peak.
I think you're
right.
If they decide that they want to keep Bennett at center, Backlund's gone. If they decide that they want to keep Bennett at left wing, I think I would keep that pairing together for the rest of the year.
Well, also, you have to look at the draft as well. And if the Flames are picking, say, fourth or fifth, then a guy like Dubois might be coming our way, and he's a 6'4" center. Well, you're not going to, like, if you're keeping him as a center and Backlund as a winger, it's the same thing, or Bennett as a winger, you're going to have the same problem of Backlund being on the third line.
Yeah, but I might almost keep Backlund until then and move him at the draft if I had to, because at least then I'd have insurance.
True. It's just that it depends on what the return is. Like, if you can get a deal done tomorrow and you're getting a full dollar return, then fine. You know, it would suck. You know, I've been saying to trade Backlund for most of the year, but I still like Backlund quite a lot. He's one of my favorite players on the team, which seems contrary, but
I think it's tough to as fans to give up on your first round pick, you know, to move away from those first round picks.
Exactly.
And then you were also mentioning you think Derek England might move. England, when we signed him, we thought he was overpaid at $2.9 million. He showed at the end of last year when Giordano went out that I think he's more talented than people thought, and he's really come around recently. What kind of return do you think the Flames might get for England?
Slightly less than what Roman Polak got. And the fact that England, when Giordano went out last year, he elevated his game. And the fact that he did that and was very noticeable in the playoffs as that physical, tough defenseman, plus his size, all of that is like prototypical what teams want in the playoffs. Now, if you're getting a second round pick for England, which could very well be possible, then the Flames can replace him internally for the rest of the season and then try to figure out something in the offseason.
Yeah, I'm looking at the guys that are probably available. I think that if I'm a GM, there's probably better options out there to spend a second on than Derek England.
Oh, yeah, I agree. It's just that with the lack of defenders on the market, you're only talking like 6 or 7 guys that are any quality. So if all those guys get dealt and you're left on the sidelines still needing a defenseman, England quickly becomes a very attractive option.
I think if England does get dealt, this will be one of those moves that probably gets announced right at the deadline or after the deadline. I think this will be a last minute move, like you said, somebody freaking out.
Yeah, like, oh, we're screwed, we need a defenseman. Hey, Calgary, you have England, we'll take him.
I personally don't kind of think thing. I understand your logic. I personally don't think we'll see England dealt this year. But, you know,
and I could see that as well. That one's the one of the veteran guys that I think is the least likely to go, but I could see a situation where it would work.
Yeah, me too. If he hadn't got suspended, I think the Dennis Wideman, he was on my list of guys to leave, but I think now with the suspension, there's no way that he's going to be moving.
It could happen, but yeah, I don't know. If teams are really...
I mean, Weidman's probably not going to be that useful for a team in the playoffs coming back that late. I think if I was a GM, I'd almost say to the Flames, look, let's do this deal, you know,
yeah,
at the draft.
I think Weidman's likely a Flame until this time next year.
Yeah, I think he's definitely got value next year on the rental market, but I'm just not sure that there's value with him sitting out for, you know, 10 more games after the deadline.
If the Flames do get the price that they're looking for, because once again, if teams are really desperate and needing a good offensive defenseman, the Flames may be able to trade him even though he is going to be suspended till the middle of March. Just don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm looking around and I can't think of a team that
with
that long of a suspension. I think even if you're desperate, I mean, you'd come calling for AHL guys before that.
I can't argue with you there. I'm I wouldn't be entirely shocked if the Flames moved him, but I don't see it happening.
So I got a couple guys here on my list that you haven't mentioned, and I've mentioned this name all year. I think that Josh Juris is going to be on his way out. I think the return on Juris is going to be similar to what we got for Reinhart in the offseason. I can see him moving for about a fourth-round pick. He, like Granlund, has been in and out of the lineup all year, and I think the Flames have finally lost some patience there. And being deep at center, I don't think that they really need to keep him around. I think they have other guys that they'd want to give a chance to. So I wouldn't be surprised to see Juris on his way out for a fourth or fifth round pick.
Yeah, and alternately, I could see him getting included in a trade with one of the other bigger name guys.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Being a secondary piece. So, yeah, I can agree with that.
Another name I think will be moved out of here. Potentially. I don't think it's imperative to move him, but I think he wouldn't be moved on his own, but as part of another deal, I could see the Flames moving Drew Shore.
Yeah.
Drew Shore is one of those guys, I believe his waiver eligibility is over now.
Yeah, we had to put him through waivers at the beginning of the season. So.
And he's never really stuck in Calgary, and if I look at the center depth on this team with guys like, you know, Derek Grant in the AHL, Turner Elson, Mitchell Hurd, you know, he's not the number one call-up anymore. And I think even looking at the depth, you know, with the NHL roster, I don't know that there's a place for him here anymore. So I wouldn't be surprised. I don't think they'll trade him by himself, but I could see him moving with Juris or him being thrown in another package to sweeten the deal.
Yeah. I'm going to disagree with you there a little bit, but I could also see him getting dealt. I think that he was really bad at the beginning of the season, and for like the first 15 to 18 games in Stockton, but in the last 20 or so, he's actually played more like he did last year. So,
ups his value.
Yeah, I think that the Flames would be more likely to have wanting to create room on the lineup so they can try him out once again in the NHL.
I don't know. My worry with trying him out, though, is if he does well, then you can't send him down.
Yeah, well, does well, then he's going to likely be the fourth line center or right winger. Like, he could very well be David Jones' replacement on the fourth line next year. So,
a lot cheaper than Jones.
Yeah, because you're dealing with a $1 million player less than instead of a $4 million guy. So I could see it if a team really wanted Shore in the deal, but I don't see the urgency to deal him.
No, I don't see an urgency, but I'm just looking that if the Flames have to include a professional prospect, a guy at the ECHL or AHL level,
yeah,
looking
oh,
up
yeah.
and down this list of forwards, I think him and Turner Elson would be the first two guys out of here.
Yeah, I can agree with that. Well, I would even add Augustino to that list if necessary.
Yeah, I think that the Flames want to keep Augustino, see what he's got, but I think, you know, Elson hasn't really impressed. I think Shore, being that guy who has had some pro time, there might be teams that want to bring him in because he could be that fourth line guy. I don't see Grant move. Well, Grant's hurt, so he can't move. And Arnold, they obviously want to keep around. You know, I don't think you get anything for, like, Bryce Van Braberent. So I can see. I had on my list here that a prospect is going to move. I don't know which one. My best guess on the front end would be Shore. On the back end, I could see Kulak moving.
Yeah, or Kalkin. Or Seeloff.
I don't think there's much value for Seeloff. Seeloff's kind of played himself out of...
He's been playing really good lately. So,
lately, but he's been so injury prone. I don't know that someone's going to want to pay for him.
Again, we'll see.
He'd almost be the kind of guy I'd lowball offer sheet and see if I could get him.
Yeah.
But yeah, I could see them trading Kulak or Kalkin. I think Kulak's been the one that's jumped between the ECHL and AHL all year.
No, that's Kalkin.
Okay, then
Kulak's
is...
been the mainstay on the blue line.
I could see Kalkin potentially going, and I don't think that there's going to be any market for Mason Raymond. I think we're stuck with that contract.
Yeah. The only... I'm going to disagree with you there. If the Flames find a team that's wanting to ditch a guy, like, say, Jonathan Bernier in Toronto, I could see Mason Raymond heading back the other way. where each team has one guy that has 1 year left, or similarly with Chicago with what's the guy's name, the guy that got sent down,
I'm not sure, let me check
the $4 million guy,
Brian Bickle.
Yeah, there you go. I could see a situation where a trade with either of those teams for those players could include Raymond, just because he has a cheaper cap hit. So,
yeah, and I wouldn't be opposed to Brian Bickle here. I think Brian Bickle could be sort of that tough guy role that we might need.
Yeah, and putting him in on the fourth line wing, he would be a disturber down there where Raymond's not really going to do much of anything.
Well, I could even see Bickle being brought up to the NHL.
Oh, he would be. Yeah.
And a guy like Bolig potentially being sent down.
Or traded. Because similarly...
Yeah, I don't know what kind of value there'd be for Bolig.
Probably a fourth or fifth.
You think you'd get that high?
Even if somebody offered a sixth or a seventh, I think you'd have to consider it.
I think the best you'd get for Bolig would be a sixth.
Huh.
What did we give up for him?
A third. Because, you know, we needed toughness.
I don't think there's much of a market for him. I've also heard the name Matt Stajan thrown around. What do you think about Stage being traded?
I could see it. Lots of teams need quality center depth, and Stajan can slot in any of the lines if necessary. And he did score that series-winning goal, so that does stick out in people's minds.
I think the management likes Stajan. He's a good guy in the room.
Yeah.
Same thing with Bolig. They've said Bolig's a good guy. So I think you'd need to get
a slight overpayment. Yeah, a slight overpayment to get rid of either of those guys.
Yeah, I think with Bolig or Stajan, just because management likes them in the room, and I mean, you know, Bolig's, you could bury that deal next year. I think you'd have to get better than market value for management to look at them.
Yeah. But, you know, if somebody wants to offer, say, a second-round pick for Stajan, okay, bye.
Yeah, but I can't
I don't see it, but...
No, I can't see in this market anyone offering that.
Yeah, but you don't know. And, yeah, stranger things have happened. Paul Gostad went for a mid-first-round pick once, so who knows?
If Laddie Smead was not hurt, could you see him moving?
Yeah, same deal as England. Just somebody wanting a physical defenseman for their third pairing extra guy. I don't think he'd get a second. I think it would be more like a fourth round pick. But yeah,
cut
I could see it.
Losses and move on.
Yeah.
So the guys on the radio today, we had Boomer and Rhett and Elliot Friedman had an interesting discussion, and Rhett is pretty much of the opinion it's time to move on from the captain of the Calgary Flames, Mark Giordano, and trade him while the iron's hot. To me, I think that's the worst thing we could do at this deadline. How do you feel?
Yeah, that's right up there with trading PK Subban in the annals of really bad decisions.
If the Flames were to trade him, I would imagine that Treliving and Burke would be in a helicopter flying far away from the dome when they make that announcement, because you want to see Flames, that building would be burned to the ground.
Yeah, the only way that would make any sense is if you got like a Red O'Bara type way overpayment, like multiple firsts plus top prospects.
Like Edmonton giving you McDavid and their first this year?
Pretty much. And I'm not even kidding. It would have to be that level of absurd.
To me, I think if Hamilton had a better year, it might be something that we might consider. But I think with Hamilton still sort of getting his feet under him and really coming into his own at 22, I think that a Brody Hamilton 1-2 would not be where we'd want to be. I think,
no.
You know, and
if you look at Chicago, because that's the team that any team should be modeling themselves over in terms of a rebuild. They had Seabrook and Keith. Okay, that's great. And the Flames sort of have that between Brody and Hamilton. That's fine. But their third guy was Brian Campbell, the veteran guy who was really one of the top defensemen at the time. And he provided that insulation that if the other two guys were having difficulties, at least you had that veteran guy who could do the job well. and he was getting paid $7 million because of the fact that he was a good defenseman. With the Flames, Giordano fits that mold. And I just don't see the need now or for the next 3 or 4 years, the need to push him out, especially the fact that the Flames are still in development mode and you need quality veterans. And unless the other team is giving you such a ridiculous overpayment where you would be stupid not to take it,
I think even in that case, when I look at this, he took a hometown discount, obviously, Gio, at 6.7.
Yeah.
I think if you're trying to negotiate with two of your biggest forward stars and you say, you know what, our captain took a hometown discount and we had no problem flipping him, I think it's going to be tough to sign some of those young guys. I think you need to keep him around until he's not effective. And to me, Gio's still effective. I think that he's one of the few guys in this team that would be untouchable. I mean, obviously, if someone offers you the moon, which realistically is not going to happen... But I don't think that you're out shopping this guy. Or if someone calls you and mentions his name, you probably hang up the phone on them. I think that Gio has to stay here for at least until, you know, the 1920 season.
Until TJ Brody's contract ends and you have to re-sign him, and if the Flames are in a cap crunch, then you could possibly look at moving away from Giordano. But that's like 3-4 years from now. So, yeah, he's cheap for what he does. I think he's probably the best veteran contract in the NHL right now for what he's bringing on the ice. And
I think he's a great captain, too.
Yeah,
I think that you'd be hard-pressed to find another leader to put the C on.
Yeah, and unless we're getting one hell of a deal, like to the point where you're going, why are you doing that other team? Yeah,
I wouldn't
even
put his name in the conversation.
Like, it would have to be, like, yeah, it would have to be such a ridiculous overpayment that it would destroy the other team's franchise. That's how bad of an overpayment it would have to be.
Well, the Coyotes are doomed anyways. They can just trade us everything they got.
Yeah.
Shut her down and move her to Vegas.
Yeah.
No, I...
Like, honestly, if... put it this way, if... Arizona, using them as an example, if they sent Domi, Duclair, a first plus Bodker, I'd still say no.
Yeah, I agree with you.
So, you know, and like that's about as absurd of an overpayment as possible, and I would still turn that down.
Yeah, no, I think that Giordano's been given the reins after Jerome left. He's a great leader. I think that he's having to deal with probably a lot with a lot of young egos in the room. To me, there's no... I couldn't sit here and think of the package it would take to pry Giordano away from this team.
Yeah. It would be a franchise crippling trade for the other team to get Giordano in my
and
book.
I think it would honestly set Calgary's rebuild back a couple of years.
Yeah, I agree. And that's why I just don't see it. Like absolutely not. Like I would see the team being more likely to trade Gaudreau than I would Giordano at this point. And that's, like, virtually zero. So, no.
So, with things the way that they sit right now, the Flames have one pick in the first three rounds of the draft.
Oh, okay. I was
all
like,
their own. So they have their
when
first,
did we
their
trade
second,
our second and our third?
Sorry.
Okay.
No, we have our first, our second, our third. We have our fourth and potentially Nashville's fourth. We acquired that for... Max Reinhardt, and we get that if he plays an undisclosed number of NHL games this year. We don't know if we'll get that yet or not. We have our fifth and our sixth and no seventh. So we essentially have...
Actually, we do technically have our seventh. It's a conditional pick, just like the Reinhardt one. And it's apparently being reported that Freddie Hamilton has to play 18 games in the NHL this season, which... If the Flames just hold him out until shortly after the trade deadline, then they get to keep their
pick. So we have one pick in every round, which is something that the Flames haven't had in a while, potentially one in the fourth. I think looking at what we've talked about and doing the math here as you were chatting, it looks to me like there's no doubt that we're going to have at least four picks in the top 60 this year.
I would be shocked if it was only four. I think it might end up being five or six, maybe even seven, depending on how crazy things get.
That would be quite crazy. Is there anyone besides, say, let's say, Giordano, Goudreau, and Monahan who you think is an untouchable on this team?
TJ Brody and Sam Bennett, and even slightly to a lesser extent, Dougie Hamilton.
Yeah, I think you're right about all those guys.
I think those six players, I think that's your core group. Our first round pick from this year, whomever it is, that'll be number seven.
Or picks.
Well, no, just our pick, because we're likely going to be in the top five.
Oh, okay.
So, that, you know, each of those guys that's in the top eight is like a really dynamite prospect that's in a similar category as Bennett and Monahan. So I think that whomever that guy is, wherever the Flames end up selecting, will be added to that list. And then, yeah, everybody else is potentially up for grabs depending on what other teams are wanting to pay.
So between you and I, we're talking about seven players possibly being moved from this team.
Yeah.
Between the forwards and the defense, and that's only guys on the roster. I didn't count Shore. So of our 21, we'd be talking 14 guys staying here, not including the goaltenders. That would be a wholesale change to this team.
Yeah. And so I think that's a necessary thing for where the Flames are. Sort of like if you look at what Toronto's been doing, they've been clearing out cap space. Like, they got rid of Kessel. They got rid of Clarkson's contract because Horton can just be on the IR. And they got rid of Phaneuf. And I think what the Flames really need desperately to do is clear out the cap space. They have about $40 million tied up in players that are replaceable.
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things hindering them going forward is how much cap room they have locked up in bottom six forwards and bottom three defensemen.
Yeah, and the Flames are further ahead in their rebuild than they should be at this point. And like even this season, if you look at where the Flames were last year, at this point in the year, in terms of pace, the Flames have actually only scored 10 goals less. And that's with Hudler regressing, Boma going from 16 goals down to, I think, one, and Weidman going from 15 goals down to two. So the fact that the Flames only dropped 10 goals from a year ago shows that the bones are still good of the team. It's just that they've also surrendered an additional 27. So the goaltending and the bottom-pairing defensemen need to be improved, and the Flames will be right back where they were. So if the Flames weren't getting like the worst goaltending in the NHL, they'd probably be closer to the playoffs than they are. So if they make wholesale changes and reallocate those cap hits elsewhere, that would be a good thing.
We'll see what happens, but we could have a very different team come the 1st of March.
Yeah, and I think with the fact that Stockton has a lot, a huge amount of NHL-ready players, that also helps. Like, it's not like you're replacing them with guys that are just absolutely not prepared for NHL hockey. So that's also a benefit.
Start saving your pennies and get ready to buy a jersey for your new favorite Flame, because you never know who might be coming in.
Yep.
Actually, this would be a terrible time to buy a jersey because I'm convinced they're getting new ones next year. But
yeah.
Well, Matt, let's recap the week that will be. And I think this week we have to also factor in the fact we may have some roster uncertainty when we're doing our predictions, because the Flames might be making some trades as we go. You and I will be recording our next show not on the deadline, but the day after. We're going to give ourselves 24 hours to kind of come down from the high of the deadline, reflect, and then talk about how things are going.
And it'll be following the Bruins game.
Hype. So we'll record following the Bruins game, and we'll release the show, if possible, as usual, on Wednesday, or it might be midday Thursday before the Buffalo game, depending on how things go. But you'll be able to enjoy your trade deadline talk, and you'll still get the show roughly the same time you would every week. So with that means that we've got five games in the docket. before we get there, let's remind everyone that TickTix brings the weekly predictions to you. TickTix connects a sea of red to buy and sell tickets securely from your phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free, and they verify the sellers so the buyers don't get ripped off when buying tickets. Tickets are delivered digitally, which is great for buyers and sellers because there's no hassle in trying to meet somebody at a parking lot or somewhere downtown to pick up the tickets. They're just automatically sent to the buyer digitally, which is great. TickTix is a free app, and it's available in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. So jump on TickTix. We got two home games this week, and then as we look forward to March, we've got two whole weeks of home games coming up. So buy your tickets. We're down to the last couple home games of the year, and make sure you get out to see this team, especially after the changes have happened. So, Matt, looking at last week, we had six games total. I predicted 2 points, or sorry, 6 points total, three games. I predicted we'd get 2 points with a win over the Wild. You thought we'd get 4 points in wins with Vancouver and Anaheim. I get 1 point for guessing correctly the number of points, but unfortunately, I got the wrong team. We ended up beating Vancouver and not the Wild.
If I didn't change things at the last second, I would have got 2 points. Oh, well.
You gotta commit. You gotta be behind your answers.
Yeah.
So I'm catching up on you. It's now 3-5. I got 3 points and you got 5 points. So if I can get 2 points this week, which I doubt I will, but if I can get 2 points, we're back tied. So five games between now and next Tuesday. More road games. We got three road games and two home games, but let's take a look at these games. On Tuesday, the Flames go to LA to take on the Kings. That's an 8:30 p.m. start time. Thursday night, the Flames are back at the Dome where the Islanders come to town at 7 p.m. And then Saturday, still at the Dome, as the nation capital Ottawa Senators join us at 8 o'clock. The Flames then have Sunday off, and they play Monday on trade deadline day. They're in Philadelphia, and that's a 5 p.m. start. And then there's a back-to-back where Tuesday night they'll travel to Boston to take on the Bruins, also at 5. So five games this week, big week for the Flames. You want to go first, or do you want me to go first?
You go ahead.
If it wasn't trade deadline week, I'd be more confident in the team this week. I think we're going to see a lot of roster uncertainty, especially near the end of the week. So I'm going to say that the Flames are going to... I think the Flames are going to beat Ottawa, and then they're going to beat the Islanders, and that's it. I'm going to go for 4 points. They're going to get the two home games.
Okay. I'm going to go with 2 points and them just beating Ottawa. I don't see a way that they beat Los Angeles with how they've been playing. The Islanders are a really good team, so I'm kind of 50-50 on that one.
The Islanders are a good team, but I can see them coming in here, especially, you know, if a deal's made before then, and underestimating the Flames a little bit.
True. And we typically don't play well against Boston or Philadelphia, so I'll just go with... I was going to say four as well, but I'll go with just the two.
The only reason I don't think we're going to beat Philly is I think we're going to have a short bench that day and a lot of new guys coming in who don't have chemistry with anybody else.
A little bit of uncertainty.
By the time we hit the ice, I would not be surprised if there's guys just barely making it to the arena on a flight who are pretty much throwing their skates on and getting out there with no chemistry. I think that's going to be a slaughter.
Yeah.
And same thing in Boston. I think playing the next day back-to-back, we know that our goalies don't play well back-to-back, and I think, again, we're going to have a lot of uncertainty on that roster.
Yeah, it's not going to be a pretty month of March, that's for sure.
I think the month of March is going to be a fun month for Flames fans because we're going to get to see a lot of new faces wearing Flaming season.
Well, if you're looking for wins from the Flames, I don't think it's going to be a nice month.
No,
but
I think you're right, but I think it's going to give us a great chance to identify some talent here. I also am not going to be surprised if we start seeing some of the AHL talent coming up for the Ottawa game. I think they're going to probably make a lot of call-ups before the deadline, simply so they can get them in before the 5 call-up rule goes in.
Yeah, same here.
So even if they're not playing, but I think who plays and who doesn't in the Ottawa game is going to be a sign of what might be coming on Monday.
And I could definitely see that, especially with the Flames already moving one player out of the pro roster. If we start seeing recalls before then and other guys sitting out, then yeah.
Yeah, no, I think if we see a day where we see like 5 recalls, I think we know that, you know, everyone's moving out. And, you know, if we look at the team, the best place to pick up Stockton players would actually be when we're in California. You know, grab them and bring them back on the plane and keep them here for the homestand. So that could be feasible, too, that we could see some guys recalled Tuesday while the Flames are down near Stockton. Because trying to get them from Stockton to Philly is going to be a pain in the butt logistically. Mm-hmm. Stockton doesn't play that day, do they?
I don't know off the top of my head.
I don't think so. Well, we will talk to you, Matt, after the trade deadline. Enjoy the trade deadline frenzy, as it's been called. And I think it's going to be a really fun day for Flames fans this year. I think that we're going to have some tears and some sadness of guys that we like leaving. But I think if we look at this long term, this could make or break this team going forward.
Yeah. Well, it'll be interesting to see. So what's all the particulars. I think the Flames are going to probably be the most active other than the Toronto Maple Leafs. So
do you think that we might see the Flames and the Leafs dealing with each other?
Could very well be, especially if that Mason Raymond for Bernier deal goes down. Who knows?
It's going to be a fun day.
Yeah, it'll be crazy. And that's always fun. You know, it's not the preferred situation for Flames fans. I'm fairly certain that everybody wanted to be where Anaheim and San Jose are. But it's the cards that were dealt, and hopefully the Flames can address the goaltending situation either by Monday or at the draft and reload for next year.
Do you have a trade deadline ritual that you go through every year? Do you, you know, sit with no pants on and watch the TSN coverage or anything special that you do on that day?
Pants on and watching, hitting the F5 button on my computer on Calgary Puck, contributing to it going down periodically, and watching the coverage on TSN or Sportsnet. One of the benefits of working by yourself for yourself is that you can take days off whenever you want. So I just booked that one off.
So that's an official holiday at your company? I got to be in class all day. I'm a teacher, so I'm in class all day that day. So I'm sure that my students will be having it up. So I usually just embrace that. And I have a little sidebar on the overhead that's going to show all the trades.
Oh, that's good.
Because otherwise they're not paying attention anyways. So I figure I might as well, you know.
Yeah, they're all just looking at their phones for, oh, so-and-so got traded. Yay.
Exactly. And I know when a trade's been made because I'll see a whole group of guys huddled together. And I'll be like, all right, who got moved? So anyway, Matt, you enjoy that day. And we will talk to you again in March. It's weird to think that it's already the end of February. But yeah, we'll be talking again in March.
Nice having this conversation. It's been a bit of a long show, but it's all good. And talk to you next week with plenty of trade deadline recap.
It'll be fun.
Take care, everybody. Thanks for listening.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.